Vegas, we are back with episode 3 of the Guest List podcast. And there's something I did read from my fellow Las Vegas degens out there. I read that the Las Vegas Sportsbook has opened up betting to 2 online gaming platforms, that is Overwatch and League of Legends. And I did notice that the number one betting sport right now is ping pong, with over $100,000 in daily wagers and up to 7 game parlays. So Vegas, we are innovating in a time of need. And also with Vegas habits, one thing that is popular in Vegas is Sunday brunch. And one thing I have noticed is that everyone is now doing Sunday brunch over Zoom while drinking their bottomless mimosas. So that is something that I do respect. And in time, we will get through this. I did notice that Wynn has announced that they will be opening mid-May. And the first aspect of the casino that they want to open is the casino floor with adequate physical distancing and sanitation methods. You're supposed to have a face mask when you enter. You're going to have a temperature reading and all that jazz. So all in time, guys, we will get through this. And moving on, I just want to give a shout out to everyone who's gave me incredible support over the last 2 episodes. Both have well over 100 downloads, the engagement, the impressions. It's all insane. So I just want to thank you guys as we can grow this platform to become the number one go-to podcast in Las Vegas. And as far as my last 2 guests, they were coronavirus related because I did feel like the information to get out there was needed in a time of uncertainty and misinformation. But going forward, the majority of my guests will not be coronavirus related, as some of them are, I'd say most of them are affected by coronavirus. They may bring it up as it pertains to themselves, but the focus will not be COVID related, as it will be their specific niche within the Las Vegas ecosystem. And this next guest, he was originally going to be my first guest on the Guest List podcast, but as the situation pertains, he is now the 3rd guest. Still important. This guy has an incredible story. He's overcame a lot of odds in the face of adversity and criticism. He's one of my good friends that I've known for him for about 10 years, going back to our college years. Over the last 6 years, he's bounced around through a few different ecosystems and is now a full force within the solar industry. That's right. He is now a co-founder of his own solar company, which is called Sunder Energy. I want to introduce to you my good friend and brother, Stephen Cohen.
What's up, man? Thanks for having me.
Dude, I appreciate it. We've been talking about this for so long now. We could finally do it.
No, I'm excited. I remember when, 3-4 months ago, you were talking on the idea. So it's super cool to see the implementation and all the branding. I'm pumped for you, man.
I appreciate it. I do want to give a note, though, to everyone who's listening. If I do happen to call him Snooky, I'm really taking an active role and not, because I feel like he has earned the title of Stephen Cohen. Back in our fraternity days, when you're rushing a fraternity, you're given a nickname, and we decided to give him the nickname Stooky because at the time, he was a little bit of prima donna. He was a little bit Jersey Shore, a little bit of a high upkeep. But you know, over time, I think through this podcast, you guys will learn that he is anything but that now. And so, Stephen, I just want to give, before we go through your incredible story, just give everyone just a brief introduction of who you are.
Absolutely, man. Well, again, thanks for having me, Jake. Appreciate it. My name is Stephen Cohen, 26 years old, native of Las Vegas. I went to Cimarron High School, represent Spartans. I'm basically just a average dude with above average goals and dreams. Before I was introduced to the concept of entrepreneurship, like Jake talked about, I rushed AE Pie, representing all my Jewish brethrens out there. One of the best experiences of my life. I met some awesome people, but I quickly realized that college wasn't really for me. As much as I love learning and, had a really good experience for the social aspect, I never really have been very good when it comes to school. I barely graduated high school with like a 2.6 GPA, so I've never really was that attentive. And then going into college, I went into college like a lot of us just because, it's what you're supposed to do. And when you don't really know what to go to college for, you go to college for business because that's what you're supposed to do. So that's kind of what I was doing. And then I quickly realized around my sophomore year, wasn't really for me, had a great time, met a lot of cool people, a lot of cool experiences, but the classroom aspect wasn't really the type of learning that I was really wanting. And I quickly realized that in life, if you want results, you know, most of us go to school to, you know, go get a job and go earn money. And if you want results, you have to go learn from people that have the results you want. And I quickly realized around my sophomore year that the people that I was listening to didn't have the results I want. You know, bless their heart, you know, college professor in business teaching me how to make a resume. It didn't really vibe with what I wanted to accomplish. I never really wanted to go work for someone else. So basically had to drop out of college, you know, got a lot of criticism for it from my friends and my parents, but for some reason, you know, it just wasn't really in my heart. And then, you know, I got introduced to entrepreneurship. There was some online companies, did that for about 3 years, never really made a lot of money, but learned a ton about entrepreneurship, sales, personal development, leadership, a bunch of stuff that I never learned in the classroom that I was really interested in. Always had a lot of ambition, just never really knew where to put that ambition. And then after my last venture, I got introduced to the solar industry. Been doing that for the last 5 years. It's been awesome. Yeah, it's been a journey, and just blessed to be in the situation and blessed to have met people like Jake and people who have really helped form me into the person I am today.
It's seriously over the last 6 years since you made that decision, it's been an incredible journey. And as you would say, I know Steven's going to give us a lot of nuggets over this conversation.
Going to try, man.
But going back to the very beginning, your sophomore year, when you decided that college for you, I'm curious, what was the influence behind that decision? Was it somebody that you met, or was it something that you read, or kind of just had this fuck it moment where you just want to do something different?
Yeah, so I got introduced to a concept called network marketing back in my sophomore year. Shout out to my boy Austin. Actually met him in Israel. Jake, you know who Austin is. He actually introduced me to it. And the first couple months, I didn't really take it seriously. And then I actually got exposed to some videos. It was actually on YouTube. And it was actually a video basically going over how college is a scam. And to preface, I don't believe college is a scam. I think college has its place. But what I don't believe in is going to college just because everyone else told you to go to college. If you're going for something that you truly believe in and a profession that you desire, I absolutely support it 100%. But I believe that a lot of people just go to college and go towards the traditional route just because everyone else is doing it, and maybe because their parents or their friends told them to do it. But in reality, that's not truly what they want for their life. So for me, getting exposed to that video, and then that really just kind of opened the rabbit hole for me to start learning more about entrepreneurship and start studying people that had the result I wanted. And I quickly realized that the time that I was investing into college that I didn't want to be there, I could be investing in my own education, whether it's wanting to, you know, create a different skill set, or whether it's wanting to start my own business or something different. But I just didn't really see the light at the end of the tunnel when it came to my experience in college. And I was just willing to do whatever it took to figure out a position where I can work for myself and not have to work for someone else for the rest of my life.
Yeah, it's something that you preach to is how YouTube opened your eyes, and it's essentially a YouTube university.
Absolutely. It's crazy to me. You know, there's so much information out there. You know, we're in the 21st century. We've never had this much access in our life. It's called the information age. You know, Jake, we're around the same age 10 years ago. It's kind of crazy. A lot of these, maybe not 10 years ago, maybe 20 years ago now. It makes me feel old. a lot of these companies that we live by every single day haven't existed. You know, Uber, Facebook, Instagram, Airbnb, YouTube, right? And like all these different companies. So the fact that a lot of people are still, I guess, doing the same model when it comes to go to school, get good grades, go find a really good job, you know, hopefully work your way up in corporate America, you know, beg for a 2-week vacation, and then eventually hopefully retire when you're 65 years old. It's crazy that people are still following that same system when the whole world has been changed upside down by technology. So the fact that you can literally go educate yourself for free, no student loan debt, no anything, but for free on YouTube and audiobooks. You can literally go type in how to create a gym, or how to create my own home-based business, or how to make $1 million. And there's people that actually have made that type of result willing to teach you for free from the comfort of your home how to do that. So I think in today's days, if people aren't going after what they want, I mean, this podcast is an example of that. It's not an issue of resources, but it's an issue of resourcefulness. They're just not willing to go out there and find the information to go make it happen.
Yeah, and I think a lot of people, especially during this pandemic, are starting to realize how political the academic system is. I mean, if you look at Yale, Harvard, and a bunch of these top colleges have released a lot of classes for free just for people to take now. And with the rising cost of tuition, it's kind of pricing out a lot of people who want to go, and they're trying to find alternative methods, or they're getting unloaded with this immense amount of student debt that they'll never be able to recover from. And now we're up to $1.5 trillion in debt. And a lot of people are moving on from this traditional model.
So fortunate, man. And I mean, me and you both know people that, you know, graduated college, bless their heart, but they're not doing anything that has to do with their degree. And now they're $30,000, $40,000, $60,000 in debt, trying to find a job to pay back the debt that they accumulated for a piece of paper that they're not even using anymore. Where if they maybe could have dedicated that 4 years into learning a skill set or to starting a business, even if... Oh, sorry about that.
Are you good? You're still back.
Even if that business wasn't successful, at least the lessons that they learned from starting their own business, as I know you know a lot about, I believe is more valuable than learning something that you have no interest and desire for long term.
100%. I'm 100% example of that. I went to UNLV, and granted, I got to go on scholarship and grants, so I don't have any amount of debt. I majored in kinesiology, and it's something that I discovered probably about around my junior year of college that it wasn't something, a field that I was going to go into. So I had to start looking into other aspects on where I wanted to progress. And one thing I found was social networking. And I think that's the big part of the college experience now people value the most, is the social aspect.
Absolutely. And that hands down is the thing that I value the most. I met some of my lifelong friends, and I'll always cherish those memories. But I believe the issue is when you ask people, why are you going to school? Whether it's, you know, high school or college, most people are going to school to make money. That's simply why you go to school. Obviously, to get an education, but that education is to go make money. Yet, I mean, the statistics and the stats, I mean, most people that graduate college go get a normal job and they end up working a subpar career for the rest of their life. And I hope people don't take offense to that, but that's the true reality of it. So the social experience is obviously the most valuable part. But I think when people realize that, hey, maybe there are other alternatives, or maybe there is a different way, and they're willing to get vulnerable and be able to take the risk in order to do that, maybe against what their parents want or what their teachers want or what they believe society wants for them, I think that's when people start tapping into that creativity and they start seeing some value for themselves and hopefully some value for the world long term.
Yeah, over my past experiences, I've become a huge proponent for experience over education. I'm the kind of person where I need to fail, or I need to feel those emotions that come along with building out a business, building relationships, learning how to set up a monitor, learning how to set up a YouTube channel or whatever business it is, building an app, outsourcing. All these different things are something that I need to go through and experience the emotions and learn how to rely on myself and learn that humanity is an aspect that you can't always rely on. And so you have to become resourceful. And in college, it's not something that they prepare you for at all.
Absolutely. Yeah, no, I believe most school prepares you to be a worker. I mean, it goes back to Jefferson Rockefeller back in the early days. He has a quote, and he's the one that invented the modern day schooling system. And he says that I want a nation of workers, not a nation of thinkers. So, I mean, if the people that are creating our schooling system and the ones that oversee all of this, and it hasn't changed in hundreds of years, that's coming from the top, it makes you start to question a little bit what the intention is behind all of this. And it's just good to be aware of. You know, I think entrepreneurship is the ultimate self-awareness journey. It really teaches you about yourself and what you're made of. And I think it's something that everyone should at least strive to try for. But it's unfortunate that most people don't believe that they have that outlet. And for me, my purpose, my vision, and what I try and preach through my company and our team is take a shot. Like, why not? Like, go start the podcast, right? Go start your dream job. Go travel the world for 6 months and get those experiences, right? You don't have to get tied down to a career for your whole life and barely pay, barely be able to pay your bills on time. Like, there's other alternatives that you can go without much experience, without, you know, a silver spoon in your mouth. But if you just try and you have the desire to have a better life, you'll get there eventually.
Yeah, It's about making yourself vulnerable. And when you do that, you realize that a lot of people surround you and they want to help. And it's not all that you're just out there alone, because there are people watching you. We are in an age of society where people are always watching, whether it's through social media or through a third person who they may know who knows you. People want to help you. And I just want to go back to your big decision when you moved on to social network marketing. What can you just take us through that experience of what exactly it is?
Yeah, no, absolutely. So it was back, I believe it was 2013, 2012. I was about 21 or 22 years old when I started dabbling. Essentially, network marketing is a online business where rather than you going to buy a product from the stores or buying a product online, they give those products to their consultants or their reps to essentially share via word of mouth. But more important for me than the business model, I believe network marketing is an awesome vehicle, not just because of the financial aspect it can gain. That's important. But I truly think that network marketing and these online marketing companies, the cool thing about it, there's a very low barrier of entry. So usually they don't cost a lot of money to get started to create your own business in the tax world. You're your own business. You're a 1099 independent contractor. But the value and the lessons that you can learn from it is absolutely invaluable. For me, network marketing, my experience, it was my gateway to entrepreneurship. It was my college for teaching me how to become a business owner and how to teach me how to become a better person all around. I think that growth is the ultimate value in anything that you do. So for me, network marketing was putting myself in an uncomfortable situation. It was stretching. It was getting the criticism. It was failing forward. Granted, I didn't make much money, but I learned so much about myself. I learned so much about these certain universal laws and lessons that school doesn't teach us on how to be happy, how to be successful, how to live the life of your dreams, how to just add value to society as a human being. And for me, that was really the pedestal or the stepping stone to give me the self-confidence, the attitude, the maturity, the wisdom to take what I learned from that endeavor and go on to bigger and better things. In my case, it's solar, but I know so many of my friends that I did network marketing with back in the day. A lot of them aren't doing it anymore, but now they're have their own personal training company, or now they're, you know, just traveling the world, living the nomad life, or they got the inspiration and the tools from that platform to go really chase their dreams and give them the lessons and mindset in order to facilitate that.
Yeah. Every gain may not be monetary. Whenever you put yourself, you have to look at it in a certain perspective and where you want to gain. Maybe you're gaining something socially, a relationship that you're going to use towards a future endeavor. Maybe you're building confidence, like you said. Maybe you're just skill stacking, which is something that Scott Adams preaches all the time. And then you make your whole entire skill set unique, and then you find your own niche, which is what a lot of your friends have done. And the thing with social network marketing, it gets a bad rep because a lot of people just already put a stamp on it as being a pyramid scheme. And that seems to be a huge mental barrier for a lot of people. How did you get past that mental barrier?
Yeah, to be honest, man, it was tough at first, right? Because the thing is, when you're used to doing what everyone else is doing your whole life, right? Conformity. My mission in life is to eliminate conformity. And conformity is essentially people doing what everyone else is doing, right? I feel like majority of people out there, and I hope people don't take offense to this, but it's the truth, they're sheep. They're sheep to the government. They're sheep to the system. They're sheep to society. And they're just essentially sedating themselves with news and media and society and mediocrity and all the things that they believe is how you live a life because of their parents and their parents and their parents' parents have taught them to be. And for me, I believe that people sometimes when they don't experience anything or when they're not educated on something, the ignorant side of them just comes out and starts putting labels on things or starts throwing shade at people. Because deep down, they're a little bit insecure because you're making moves or you're doing something that's uncomfortable. And deep down, they wish they could do it. But because they can't, they're throwing shade at it. So network marketing, again, claimer, I don't do it anymore. But network marketing, I think, is a beautiful opportunity that I wish more people got involved in, whether it's for a year or 2 years, just because of what it teaches you and the skill set it gives you. But no, for me, it definitely was hard at first because, you know, I didn't have results, right? I was preaching, you know, how you should read books and how you, you know, live in this life. But at the end of the day, I wasn't living that life, right? I was trying to, and I was making progress. But at the same time, I understand where people were coming from, because at the end of the day, the best way to make your friends believe in you, your peers, your family, right? If you want people to believe in what you're doing, get results, right? Because if you don't have results, then it's not really their fault for not believing at you, because truly deep down, I believe that they really do want what's best for you. But the issue with that is if you're always operating off of what you believe others want for you, then you're not listening to your own inner dialogue, right? That intuition, because the only person that knows what's best for you is you. So it took me a while for me to understand that, right? I used to take offense to it, and it used to, you know, I used to take it personal, right? That's another thing that I've learned to do, not take things personal. You know, Four Agreements, great book. Shout out to that. Definitely recommend that. But for me, it was really just understanding that at the end of the day, no one's opinions are going to pay my bills for me, right? No one's opinions are going to buy my parents a home or retire them or make sure that I'm living the dream life that I want. So I just need to focus on myself, cut out the noise, and then just let my results do the talking. And for me, that was really the moment where I was like, you know what? You know, I don't care what other people think. I know what I believe in. And once you make like a stern choice of like, yo, this is who I am, this is what I believe in, at that point, it doesn't really matter what anyone else thinks. Now it's just time until they figure out, you know, whether you're serious or not. And then that's up to you to go and do the work every day.
Yeah, it's for all those people of success, or even the people that take the leap of faith, you start to notice in the beginning that you do have a close circle who supports you. But, you know, when you make an announcement into a new business endeavor, at least when you make a post on social media, you usually don't get that many likes as a favor to somebody who's going to post a picture of a piece of pizza that gets 300 likes. Because right. You said a lot of people see that sort of ignorant personality inside of them, and they're afraid to show it. But once you start building success, and then you start seeing all those people in the beginning who are kind of hiding their support from you, start to hop on the support train.
Yep. It's really funny. Like, to your point, right? You can post, oh, I just started a new online business, something like that, and get 10 likes. Or you can say, oh, I just got a new job at, you know, corporate America, and get like 150 likes, right? And it's just funny because that's just the conditioning that we grew up with through society. 97% of the country is broke. 3% of the world owns 97% of the wealth, which means most likely most of the people we come on a date on a contact with on a daily basis, our friends, our family, our parents, our teachers, our pastors, right? All the people that we deal with on a daily basis, they don't know how to create wealth. They don't know how to create fulfillment, wealth, and freedom in their life. And that's not even their fault. It's just the way that the system is. So I don't blame people for not doing that, or for when people launches a new business or does a podcast or does something that is against the norm, right? That is going against conformity, for people maybe not to be attracted to it or to shy away from it. Because again, it's questioning, it makes them question what they're doing with their life. And one or two things are going to happen. When you do something big in life, or you're striving to do something big, you're going to get people that are going to support you, and because they're going to be inspired by it, or you're going to get people that hate on you and they kind of push against it because they're questioning what they're doing with their own life. And instead of them being inspired and making a change and taking value from what you're doing, they take offense to it because now they're like, well, if he's doing X, Y, and Z, what am I doing? And instead of taking action on that, they use it to, you know, create noise and gossip and all these things that aren't really moving the needle forward in their own life.
Yeah, and a lot of these forward thinkers and innovators and doers are usually aware that you usually don't succeed on your first time. There's usually not a perfect start. It's something that I've been telling people. And in the first episode of this podcast, I was telling people that this isn't going to be a perfect start. I may not be as fluid in my conversation, but over time you build and you critique yourself, and it's just a giant stepping stone. And sometimes when you're walking up that staircase, you may fall down 3 stairs, but eventually you're going to make your way up to the top into the pedestal that you want to be. And like, from my own experience, this would be my 3rd or 4th, you know, I have 2 quote unquote failed businesses beforehand, but I wouldn't consider them failed because I learned how to social network. I learned how to rely on myself. I learned how to outsource and all these other different skills, which has ultimately led up to starting this podcast and being able to have a network to build on top of that.
Exactly. And to your point, man, failure, that was a big thing that I learned that I had to create a new relationship with, because maybe 4 or 5 years ago, when I thought of failure, I thought of something bad or negative. But then as I started studying the people that had the results I want, the millionaires, the billionaires, the people living their dreams, the people traveling the world, failure, their relationship to failure is, like you said, man, it's a stepping stone, right? It's a learning lesson, right? Either you win or you learn, right? Not lose. And I think, again, that stems back to our social conditioning from the school system, right? When you go to school and you go get a grade on a test, right? You get a fail and you're bad, right? You get home, your parents yell at you. And like from an early age, we start to create these conditionings in our mind that, you know, that equate failing with something bad. But in reality, if you look at any of the most successful people on the planet, whether it's CEOs of companies like Apple, or like, you know, Martin Luther King, right, or like some of the great of the greats, all of them have to fail and fail and fail and fail and fail, because failure is not something bad. You know, I believe in failing forward, fail faster, fail quicker, because the quicker that you fail, the quicker that you're going to find what you're trying to get done. And the lessons that you learn amongst the way are way more valuable than if you just would have won your first business. I mean, for you, man, I mean, going through those first couple of business set you up to be able to do something like this, that eventually 5 years from now, 10 years from now, I guarantee you, you'll look at as some of the biggest just learning experiences and catapults of your future success and what you're trying to do.
Yeah, one of my favorite books that I ever read, and I advise everyone to read it. It's called Shoe Dog, which is the story of Phil Knight, who's the founder of Nike. And he didn't make his first dollar on Nike until his 17th year, when he IPO'd, and he was running at negative or even cash flow for such a long time. But he didn't give up on himself, and he built a network around himself and with the people that he wanted, and he just believed, and over time he finally got to that stepping stone. But not until 17 years later, when he was in his 50s or 40, it was 40s or 50s. But it just goes to show that as long as you continue on what you're doing, the road may seem dark, and the age doesn't really matter. I know a lot of younger people, they have this almost quarter life crisis once you get out of college, where once reality finally punches you in their face and you can't get a job, you're just like, oh shit, what am I gonna do now? It's a weird experience, and it's something that I personally went through for about 6 months until I found out that my degree wasn't gonna do it. And I may use my degree for myself as far as like health science and use it in everyday application, but as far as a professional level, it wasn't something to do. And I just want to go on back to your story. That was incredible. Those are some good first Snooki Nuggets. Steven Nuggets. But once you started going through your social networking, what was your next step, or what was your decision to exit that onto something else?
Absolutely. So I did network marketing for about 3 years. I hopped around a couple different companies. Again, didn't really make that much success on a monetary gain. I did build teams, network marketing. It's all about, leadership and team building and all these cool skill sets, recruitment, which I can talk about in a little bit. A lot of people have a negative connotation with recruitment, which is just the complete opposite, standpoint. But, and then after 3 years, I basically looked at myself, and I had to realize, after my third company didn't really work out, I made a commitment to myself that if this didn't work out, I was going to go do something else. I didn't know what that else was, but I just knew that after 3 years, I felt like a completely different person. My bank account maybe didn't reflect that, but like I said, I felt more confident. I had a good network of people. I was reading books. I was listening to YouTube and audio, and I, you know, had more experiences. I just felt like a completely transformed person, but I just couldn't understand why my bank account still didn't show that. Now, still working at Planet Hollywood. Shout out to you. You're the one that got me that job. It was great. It was a great job, great experience, but I just always knew that I wanted more. And even though I was doing network marketing part-time for 3 months or 3 years while still doing my job, I just knew there was something else out there. So after my last company didn't really work out, I made a commitment that I'm going to start looking for other stuff. And then that's when my buddy, Austin, funny enough, he's been a big part of my life, hit me up about another opportunity to go do door-to-door sales, actually, pest control in New Jersey. And it was me and three of our buddies that we did network marketing with. And I was like, you know what, this is it. I just, you know, made the commitment that, hey, kind of done with network marketing. I appreciate, grateful for it. I learned a lot, but I need to move on to the next failure, right? In a lot of people's eyes at that time, I could have looked like a failure. Steven, you did 3 years of network marketing. You dropped out of college and you quit your job and you have nothing to show for it. Like, in people's eyes, right, it could look for failure. But for me, it was like, I'm a whole new person. I'm so much more valuable in my heart than I was 3 years ago. So got involved in network or in direct sales and door to door. Basically dropped my life. That's actually when I quit Planet Hollywood. And I went out to go do this pest control job with me and three or four of my buddies for the summer. And, went out there, man. And to be honest, for 3 days, it just wasn't for me. Went out there, told everyone again, right? I'm going to go make all this money, just wait, all these people that I'm going to prove all you guys wrong. And I go out there and I just wasn't for me. Like, I was homesick. The vibe wasn't right. I couldn't get passionate about the product that I was selling. And, I just really trusted my intuition at that time. And I was like, you know what? Something isn't right for me right now. And I ended up leaving that. And again, even some of my good friends at the time were like, Stephen, how can you, bro? Like, you're a quitter, like all this stuff going on. And to be honest, that was probably the lowest point of my entrepreneur journey, because I thought I was quitting on myself. After everything I learned in network marketing, I thought I was going to go crush this, and I got a big reality check, and it wasn't that easy. So I ended up staying in New York at the time. So the company was based in New Jersey. I went to go stay with my family in New York for 3 weeks because I couldn't afford a plane ticket back. I was that broke that I literally just spent all the money that I went out there. This is back in 2000 and about 5 years ago now. So like 2015 or 2014, something like that. And ended up saving some money working with my uncle at his like glass shop and bought a ticket back. And I just didn't really know what to do with myself. And I was like, man, right? Like, I definitely had too much pride to go back to a normal 9-to-5. I've been preaching anti, 9-to-5 for a very long time. But I didn't really know what I was going to do. And it was a really low point in my life. I was broke. I didn't have a purpose, just because I, for the last 3 years, even though I didn't really have that much money, I was building towards something I was passionate about. And then thankfully, one of my friends who I did network marketing with told me about this solar opportunity door to door. And I was a little hesitant at first, just because I had not the best experience door to door. I was kind of scared of my shadow and didn't really have the confidence yet to go out there and speak to people at their home. It was definitely a big gut check for me. But it was kind of one of those situations. I'm a firm believer that every great thing in life either stems from inspiration or desperation. Either you're super inspired to go make a change in your life and you go do something great, or your back's against a wall and you're basically do or die, fight or flight mentality, and you have to make something happen. For me, I had a lot of both. I had a massive inspiration to go do something big with my life, prove a lot of people wrong, and take care of my family. But I also was back against the wall. I knew I had bills coming. I know my parents had bills coming, and I didn't really have any other choice. So basically got hooked up with solar and just fully commit, man. I surrendered to the process. And, within 4 months, I started making some really good money. I was making $6,000-$7,000 a month, which at the time was a lot more money I've ever made in my life. And as I started getting some momentum, the market shut down in 2015 in Vegas, literally overnight. Some of you guys may remember, solar just goodbye. Basically, the utility company was losing too much money, and with corrupt politics and stuff, they shut us down. So I ended up moving, me and my eight-man team, some of my friends, we moved to Denver, Colorado. First time moving away from my parents, first time living away from myself. Was there for 3 months, and then we did so well that the CEO moved us to San Jose, California. Was there for a year, then we crushed it there. Then I moved down to Southern California and San Diego and built a really big team there. And thankfully, about 2 years into San Diego, the market reopened back in Vegas, and I was able to come back. But from then till now, from when I first started by myself till now, through that process, we've been able to build a pretty big organization of about 200 people, 220 people across the country. And it's been a really cool experience, man. But it all stemmed from being that rock bottom to, I need to make something happen. I have way too much pride and way too much conviction of who I want to be and what I want to do, that there's no way this isn't going to happen. And, it's funny, when you make a true commitment and you plant the flag in the ground, it's like the universe wants to get out of your way. It's like, this dude's either going to make it happen or he's going to die trying. We might as well just make him let it happen.
Yeah. There's a lot of psychological reasoning behind that. A big thing in success is mindfulness, being able to be aware of how you were feeling in that situation. And in that situation, after 3 days, you're just like, no, this is not for me. And a lot of people will continue to do it because of maybe some outside social pressures, like people in college. People realize a lot of times that people who change their major 6 or 7 times but still continue on to be in college, where they don't realize that that's the broken thing is college and not their decision and the overall system. And you realize that maybe door to door wasn't for you at the time, which you eventually came back to, which gave you passion. but you're aware to recognize that pattern that was broken. And so you just basically put a halt on it and then decided to stay with your uncle and then go back home and refigure it out until an opportunity presented itself. Maybe it seemed like destined at the time, but it is all about that skill stack, and your social network is the one who ended up bringing you back to it through maybe some trust.
Yeah, it's funny. Steve Jobs has a video and he talks about, you know, it's impossible to see the dots connecting forward, but when you can connect the dots looking backwards, you can literally tell how every little decision, every moment led yourself up to be where you are right now. And, you know, I think if anyone could learn anything from that story, it's just through that whole time, I may have been down, I may have been, you know, questioning myself and a little bit, you know, just kind of worried about what was going to happen, but I never lost track of that original vision that I had of, you know, becoming an entrepreneur, being able to create my own schedule, having time freedom, not having a cap on my income. And then what happened is me staying consistent, even through the quote unquote failures, the universe, God, marketplace, whatever you believe in, provided me with the people, the resources, and the circumstances to eventually manifest what I was trying to accomplish.
Yeah, it's easy to look at things retroactively. Just coming from my own perspective, when you trade like financial markets, you're like, oh, I missed out on that trade. I could have made this much money. And then you did that. Your heart just starts beating super fast because you missed out on it. But in the time, you didn't think it was a correct decision because the road was still hugely unknown on what was going on. And so looking back, like through your success, it may seem like everything lined up perfectly, but in the time it was not at all perfect at all. The dots were scattered. And it's funny you say that Steve Jobs quote, because that is something that was actually my home screen on my laptop for such a long time. That speech, was it the Stanford speech, right?
I think so.
Yeah, it's such a moving and incredible story. And everyone faces those times of despair. And it's whether you want to succumb to the pressures and give up on yourself, or like you said, you want to plant the flag and say, this is rock bottom. And from here, I'm only trajectorying myself upwards.
That's it. And it goes back to that key principle that I live by. It's like, who are you listening to, right? Are you listening to your friends that are telling you to just give it up and go get a real job, or your parents saying, hey, maybe you should just go get a real job so you can pay your bills? Or are you listening to people like Steve Jobs and like, you know, Tim Cook and Phil Knight and all these people? And I think it's just something people can learn. It's just making sure you're mindful of the information that you're allowing to go into your mind. Because at the end of the day, we're like computers, right? Whatever we input, we'll output. So we want to make sure that the programs going into our mind are not viruses, but programs that are conducive to what we're trying to accomplish.
That is, it's very, very well put. Going back to that, essentially, what you'd consider your first leap of faith, where you took your team of eight over to Colorado the first time, moving away from home. Where did this team of eight come from, and what was that experience like?
For sure, man. That was definitely like the real gut check, because again, I had a past kind of failure where when I moved to New Jersey, it was only a temporary move. It was supposed to be, you go out there for 4 months, you sell a lot, and then you go back. So technically I was still living in Vegas with my parents. I was just kind of going as for like a summer camp field trip for sales. Right. So when this whole move came for Colorado, again, it literally happened overnight. Like one moment we were selling solar, things were going great. And the next, like the market crashed, like, holy shit, we have to move within 3 days. Like if we want to still like keep our job, it was intense. So to answer that question, so the team came just for me passively building. So in the direct sales model, in a normal, you know, maybe a normal job, right? Starbucks, right? In order to get promoted to a manager or move up or corporate America, right? You have to be there for X amount of time. You got to kiss a little bit of butt, and you got to obviously show that you want the promotion, right? And then you get promoted, and then they put people under you to promote. In any type of job or any type of business, in my opinion, if you want to create a business or create a following or create a team, right? You have to attract those people into your team, right? So for me, thankfully, again, recruiting came into play. So in network marketing, I learned the skill set of recruiting. And I kind of talked about this earlier, but a lot of people have a negative connotation when it comes to recruiting because they think that you're trying to get something from someone else. Same thing with sales. A lot of people think sales are bad because I'm a slimy salesman and I need to sell you something. When in reality, sales and recruiting are a skill set that everyone practices, whether they know it or not, right? If you want anything in life, you're going to have to either find people to help you accomplish your vision, or you're going to have to sell someone on why they should do what you want them to do, right? For example, if you have a girlfriend or a boyfriend, you have to continuously sell your boyfriend and girlfriend on why you should stay in a relationship. If you're a parent, you need to sell your kids on why they should listen to you or why they should eat their vegetables, right? Everything we do is a sale, but most people don't think about it in that context. And they don't practice the skill set of it because it is a skill set. Same thing with recruiting. You look at the most successful organizations on the world, the military, they recruit. Churches, they recruit. Colleges, they recruit. Sports teams, they recruit. What are they doing? They're looking for talent to expand their vision and help create or help get to their cause. It's the same exact thing. So when I practiced for 3 years, didn't make money, but I was learning the skill sets that I needed to make money. The art of recruiting, it was very easy to come into a business like Solar, where once I started selling and making that income that I was talking about, it was very easy for me to find other motivated people as well through social media. Funny thing is I didn't reach out to a single person. Everyone came to me. And I essentially found people that wanted to do what I did and wanted to and believe the same thing that I believed. They attracted. So yeah, I had a team of 7 people. There was only 4 from Vegas. The other 3 like flew out from California and other places. And it was a squad, man. And you know, when the whole thing happened, it was cool. It was super scary. Because I mean, we literally like in one day we found out the market crashed, and within 2 days we were packing up U-Hauls, trying to find, like we signed a lease at a place that we didn't even know that we looked at before. Right. Like it was a crazy experience, but because of that experience and because of the communal bond, this is one thing that the fraternity really taught me as well. There's power in community. There's something about that fraternal bond. When you look to your left and you look to your right and you know that they got your back no matter what, cause you believe in the same type of thing. You're going for a similar cause. That was the feeling that we had. So it didn't matter that the whole world was crashing around us. It didn't matter that none of us lived in Colorado. We moved January 7th. None of us had dealt with snow before. It was literally blizzarding the whole time. But it didn't really matter because we knew what we were doing. We knew why we were doing it. And there was absolutely nothing that was going to stop us from accomplishing what we wanted to.
Yeah, there's a huge power in being a part of a group that's larger than yourself with maybe not even just one goal in mind, but a few goals. And like when I was in fraternity, I was a rush chair. So I had to learn the different tactics that you have to make in order to recruit Jewish guys into the fraternity and convince them that we don't essentially need them, which we do, but how this is going to improve them in many different aspects of their life. And they're going to be good at organizing and then eventually recruiting and socializing and job building and whatever the case is. And when you build such a large community or organization around you, it pushes you to do things that you would never expect yourself to even do or that you could even dream of. And I know that was the case for you when you're out in Colorado, where you ended up building one of the #1 sales teams in the nation, correct?
Yep, absolutely. Yeah, we went out there for 3 months. We started with 8 people. Again, none of us have ever been to Colorado before. It was a brand new market for our company at the time. So no one knew anything about it. We'd have to figure out the utility company. We had to figure out where we were living. We didn't know what the heck was going on. Funny enough, it was the same couple months that the Broncos won the Super Bowl. I know. Ooh, you love that, Jake.
Shout out. Broncos fan. Shout out.
So just there's just so much like universal, just like good karma on our side, right? Like the Broncos are crushing it. Like we're crushing it. It was just like, it was hands down one of the best experiences of my life. But yeah, we went out there with 8 people originally for the first like 3 weeks. We didn't know what the heck we were doing. We barely got 1 lead to put in perspective, right? Like we're putting in like, I don't know, like a 10-man team should be putting in, I don't know, maybe like 10 leads a day in 3 weeks. 20 of us couldn't get 1 lead, or not 20 of us, but like 10 of us couldn't get 1 lead. So it took a little bit to break the resistance down. And I mean, people were like getting sick because of the elevation poison, because none of us have ever dealt with it before. So the first couple of weeks were definitely a little bit challenging, but again, we made it fun because we knew why we were there and we surrendered to the journey, right? We were 100% vulnerable. And the mindset of every single person was either we're going to make this happen and make success out of this, or we're literally going to be frozen outside of Colorado because we can't pay our bills. There was no plan B. And we made it happen, man. Within 2 months, we had like 28 people. Within the third month, we were the #1 team in the company, selling over 100 accounts. And we were doing so good that the CEO of our previous company at the time flew down and was like, hey, I don't know what you guys are doing. I don't know who you guys are, but I love your energy. I love your culture. I love how you're all young and hungry and just like devoted to the cause. I want you guys to move to San Jose, California, because you'll make more money. We'll make more money. Long story short, Solar is more profitable in California and it'll be a win-win. And literally, like most of us just signed our first month rent lease. We were living like out of Airbnbs and temporary housing. And he came down and we were like, bet, like, let's do it. Whatever you say, we will. So we dropped $80,000 to buy us U-Hauls, break our month lease at in Denver's apartments, buy us first month rent in San Jose, California, in high rises, some of the most expensive real estate in the country, which had, looking back, it wasn't smart for, you know, 22-year-old kids to sign, you know, $4,000 a month leases, but we did it anyway. And yeah, we made it happen, man. And then we moved to San Jose 3 months in. And again, in April, first month, got dominated. California at the time was this really scary solar market that no one really could get down because it's California. And first month we bought into that and we didn't see any success. And then by second month we started crushing it. And then within 4 months of being there, we won like the biggest sales competition in the country, won a free cruise to Cabo. And it turned into kind of like a Cinderella story. So it was super cool. But then after that, bad things happened. But yeah, it's part of the game.
Yeah, I think this success is because you become accustomed to preparing yourself for the failure, which is inevitably going to happen in the beginning, and not framing it as failure, but looking at it as different critiques that are going to be made into your game plan. And I think, I think your leadership now shows a lot of remnants from maybe your Colorado days and the San Jose days. And you see a lot of this unique and innovative leadership, which is what inspires all of your team underneath you and helped you grow up to up to 200 people now.
I know, amen, man. And I, you know, I think this comes down to really anything in life. I mean, I think success is all the same. The principles are the same. The mechanics may be a little bit different, but I think the principle and the mindset is exactly the same when it comes to any type of success in any industry. But I think the reason that most people don't follow their dreams, or they're not, you know, living the life maybe they want, or, you know, whatever the case is, maybe they're not happy with their financial situation, their car they drive, or the apartment they live in, or whatever. It's not because they're not good enough. It's not because they're not smart enough. It's not because they're not worthy. It's none of that. It's simply because they're not willing to put themselves in an uncomfortable, vulnerable situation to give themselves their chance to succeed. That's it. Most people don't succeed is because they don't put themselves in a vulnerable situation to give themselves the opportunity to succeed. Most people are comfortable in their situation, and maybe they're not happy with it. Maybe they're not stoked with it, but they know what it is and it's familiar to them. And staying over here is way better than going in this uncomfortable unknown. But in reality, it's not, because the only way to grow and become the person that you need to is by putting yourself in that uncomfortable unknown. Because by you doing that and giving yourself no way out, you start figuring out who you really are as a person and how capable you are. And that's really where the magic starts to happen.
Yeah. There's going back to college, when you have all the new members interview you, they always ask like, what's your number one tip in order to succeed in college, whether it's socially, academically, or whatever the case is. I'd always tell people that it's about going down the path of uncomfortableness. And what I mean by that is, you imagine like a yellow brick road, right? And if there's the light at the end of the tunnel on where you want to be, and you're all the way at the start and you're in this bubble, eventually, if you want to get down to that light at the end of the tunnel, you have to step outside this bubble and to feel comfortable. But eventually, over time, once you start making it down the path of where greatness is going to be, your comfortable bubble catches up with you. So now you're halfway down this road, but you still feel comfortable and all. And you realize that it was just a giant myth the whole time, and you're just psyching yourself out in different mental capacities. And it's hard for some people to realize that. But once you do the first maybe handful of uncomfortable tasks, you realize that everything is a skill and it's not like a born trait. And all it does is just take time and confidence in yourself.
Amen, man. Yeah. Amen. No, I agree with that 100%. I mean, I pull confidence and I pull faith from those moves and from my past history and from me putting myself in uncomfortable situations. So when I face more adversity and I face more scary things and I face more things that I'm uncertain about, I'm able to use the experiences that I've gone through to help feed the confidence in what I can accomplish, to give me the faith and confidence to push forward into the unknown and into that uncomfortableness.
Yeah. And then eventually you realize that there's no obstacle that's too tall to overcome. And like you were saying earlier, once you left San Jose, you started seeing a lot of obstacles in the way. Can you just explain what those were and how you overcame them?
Yeah, absolutely. And so it felt like after we won this really big sales competition, like I kid you not, like the morning after we had like a, again, we're living in like, I had like a penthouse on the 22nd floor of San Jose High Rise. It was super dope. And again, 4 months before that, keep in mind, I was living with my parents in like a 600 square foot condo. So it was a big, big shift, right? But after we won the competition, like we had a big party the night, the celebration party the night. And I woke up that next morning and I literally felt like I could die and like my life would be okay. Like I was so just like whole and just so at peace with everything we accomplished that it was awesome. But as good as the feeling that was, I felt like I carried that feeling with me too long and I took my foot off the gas a little bit. And then because of that, the marketplace is like, yo, you're just getting started, man. Like you can't be chilling right now. And then, you know, obviously things started happening. But yeah, after San Jose, you know, we had a good run. And then I had the opportunity to move down to San Diego to join one of the teams that originally. So we started with 50 guys in San Jose after we won the sales competition. About half of those guys moved to San Diego to start a new team in Southern California. And then about 6 months after they moved, I moved down there to join them. And I became the regional of Southern California. So I was basically responsible for San Diego, Orange County, and then Inland Empire. And I was there for a year in San Diego. It was in 2017. And 2017 was a challenging year for me. I was still making pretty good money, but I basically plateaued my income from what I did in 2016. So I wasn't happy about that. I'm the type of person that I need to be progressing. I'm a firm believer. Either you're progressing forward or you're regressing backwards. There's no stagnancy, right? Either you're growing or you're dying. And I just felt like I wasn't in the situation that I wanted to be. Like I was traveling from, you know, Orange County, like every weekend, I'd either be in Orange County, Chino Hills, or San Diego, driving up and down Southern California, all this stuff, but there was just resistance everywhere, right? Like the team was doing okay, but not as good as what we could have been. And there's just a lot of resistance. But if there's one thing I learned from 2017, it's like sometimes, you know, there's seasons in people's lives, right? There's different peaks and valleys, right? There's going to be seasons of growth. There's going to be seasons of harvest. There's going to be seasons of shelter and hibernations. There's different seasons. You can't fight the seasons, right? Just like there's fall, there's, you know, autumn, right? There's winter, there's summer, right? They're going to come. It's just a natural cycle. I believe there's seasons in people's lives. You can't fight the seasons, but you can be mindful and aware what season you're in and act accordingly. After 2017, that's what it taught me, is to be mindful of the season we were in. After 2017, it wasn't the best year, but you know, I learned a lot. And then every year since then, 2018 crushed it, 19 crushed it, 20 plan on crushing it. So it was a great learning experience overall.
It's interesting. I've actually never heard that mindset before. I always talk about life as like riding the wave. There's peaks and there's lows, but it didn't come to mind that there can also be seasonality towards it. You know, some days it's going to be bright and happiness, and other days it's going to feel gloomy, but you still may be on the ride up to where you need to be. And so it's actually an excellent outlook. And so continuing on your journey, once you're this regional recruiter, you eventually make your way back home, back to Vegas, because finally the politics behind solar was crushed, and Vegas and Nevada decided to vote in solar power because they see it's a future as Nevada begins to become more progressive. What happened once you got back to Vegas?
Yeah, so for me, when Vegas reopened, it was almost like a dream come true. Because as much fun as I was having, and you know, as much, you know, awesome experiences, how much I'd grown as a person, there was always a place in my heart where I wanted to come back to Vegas. I had a girlfriend at the time as well, Nicole. You know her, Jake. So we were doing long distance. So I really wanted to get back to her as well. So there's a lot of emotional ties, but also strategically, there's a lot of business ties, just because Vegas is my backyard. I live here. I grew up here. So my networking ability, my influence, right? I knew as soon as that thing opened, I'd be able to take it over and it'd be a whole nother market with a whole nother team of people who just didn't want to drop their life and move to Colorado or California. So as soon as I found out it was open, I was freaking stoked. And it happened early 2018. So again, 2017 was in SoCal. It was a great year overall as a person financially and like business. It wasn't the greatest year. And then as soon as 2018 hit, had a phenomenal New Year's. I usually base the year off of how well the New Year's is, just because I'm a firm believer, right? You want to start the year strong with really good intention. And you kind of just get that gut feeling. It's like, you know, this is going to be a good year. And it really was, man. So the market reopened. I was super stoked. I actually, there was a little bit of politics in my former company. So it actually took a little bit of navigating and showing my value for me to like make them realize like I wasn't as needed in Southern California and I could move to Vegas and basically do both. Because at the time I was still responsible for Southern California. So they're like, wait, Steven, you're trying to move to Vegas and still be the regional manager of Southern California? I'm like, yeah, of course I am. So I ended up, you know, all that ended up doing. And yeah, man, as soon as the market reopened, it was awesome. I was able to work with a lot of people that I miss working with. We built pretty quick, as well as the original San Jose team that I was with actually decided to move back to Vegas as well, because that's where they were all from as well. And we crushed it, man. It was almost like a dream come true because, you know, at the time, I almost felt like I was out on war, like a military, right? I'm not in the military, but I would imagine when you're in the military and you're out doing your service, whether it's 2 or 4 years and you're out in Iraq or you're out on basic duty, you know that like you're out there for a mission and for a reason and you love it and your brothers are with you and it's a great experience. You know, you're out there for, essentially almost like a war, but you know where your home is, you know where your family is, you know where you want to always get back to once the mission is accomplished. And that's what it felt for me. I felt like I paid my dues for 2.5 years and I built a lot. I became such a better individual all around. So when it reopened, I was stoked and I knew I was going to crush it. And that's what we did. I mean, within the first 6 months, we had a team of like 35 people. And then 2018 was an awesome year. I was the number one region in the company every month for the first 12 months between Southern California teams and Vegas. They were just absolutely crushing it. And overall, it was just an awesome year. And that's really where my income started to double, which was awesome just because we were able to do another team like that. And it was just an awesome experience just being home. But it was super cool because being gone for 2.5 years, and I'm sure people listening that moved away from Vegas and then maybe came back can relate. It's very interesting to see because every time I would come home because every month I'd come back to see my family and my girlfriend and stuff. It was just interesting to see people still doing the same thing. Like 6, 7, 8 months would go by and I'd literally come back and like, it'd be like nothing changed in some people's lives that I used to, you know, hang out with and stuff. And it was just so interesting to me because a lot of time would go by and they'd still be doing the same thing, going to the same clubs. And again, nothing against that, but it was just very interesting for me to see kind of the lack of progress or the lack of intuitiveness of to do something different. And then moving back, it was interesting for me because I was like, part of me wanted my old life back because before I left, I was a different person and I wanted to still associate with the same people. But the other part of me knew that I couldn't because I knew maybe I was up here, not because I'm better than anyone else, just where my mindset was and where my vision and my goals were. And a lot of the people I used to associate with were down there in terms of what they wanted out of life. So I knew that it just wouldn't correspond well together. So for me, adapting back to kind of like wanting my old life again and still having that sense of home and people that I used to hang out with while being able to operate as the new Steven Cohen within this new, you know, life.
Yeah, Vegas is a unique town. It's one of the only in the world. And it's easy to get caught up into what I like to call the vicious Vegas cycle. And it was something that I wasn't actually able to break out of until a few years ago where, you know, you wake up and you're right. And you just chill and waiting around. And then you go to the club, get invited, you meet a few people, maybe you go chase some females or whatever you're interested in. And then you wake up hungover the next day. And then those people that you met invited you out to the next night to go out and party. And, you know, it's a lavish lifestyle and it's filled with a lot of likes and you build like a lot of social equity into different people who may be entrepreneurs or maybe have a lot of money. But you're never really advancing yourself. You're only maybe trying to leech off of these people that you met, and you're only building social equity into these people, and you're not putting any equity into where you want to further yourself. And so that kind of trapping happens a lot in Vegas. And it's really hard to notice that you're in this cycle until something drastic happens in your life, and you eventually step out of that circle and you're just like, wow, I was caught up in that for so long. And now I have pretty much nothing to show for me. Maybe you have some money and all these friends, but as far as like a career advantage, you're just standing put by yourself.
Absolutely, man. Yeah. It's kind of hard to see the big picture when you're standing in the frame and, you know, I don't think there's anything wrong with that. What kind of irks me and is like, bro, you should probably know better is like, there's a difference between people talking about what they want and people just kind of doing whatever they want, right? Like if people want to live their life that way, I don't judge, right? I think everyone's on different journeys in life and they're all, you know, learning new things and they all have a purpose. And some people it takes longer, some people shorter, but everyone's unique and different. But for the people that say, oh, I want this car, I want a better life, or I want freedom, and then they're doing that consistently, they're not, whatever there's coming out of their mouth, their actions and their values aren't congruent with that. That's when I'm like, hey man, like it's not rocket science. We all know what we should be doing, right? Everyone knows what they should be doing. If I wanted a six pack, I knew how to get a six pack. Go to the gym 5 times a week, consistently, every single week, drink a lot of water, eat really clean and good, go find a professional coach who can help me and take my nutrients. But I don't do that because I'm just not, right? So I can't get upset for not having a six pack if I'm not willing to do what it takes. It's the same thing, right? If you ask 100 people, like, do you want to be successful, or do you want to travel the world, or do you want a Lamborghini or whatever, everyone's going to say, yeah, I'd love one. But very few, I would argue, probably like 98% of them aren't willing to do what it takes consistently, even though they know what they should take. They know they should be reading books. They know they should be working hard. They know they should go find a business that they have unlimited potential in. But because they're not willing to do it, then it's like now you're just chipping away at your own self-confidence. Because when you do things, when you say something and you don't do it, just like Jake, if I told you I was going to be on this podcast and then I bailed on you, you would lose confidence in me, right? You would lose trust in me. The same thing happens with us. I believe how you create self-confidence is by just keeping the promises you tell yourself that you're going to do, right? If you tell yourself you're going to wake up at 8 a.m. and you don't wake up at 8 a.m., you just now are chipping away at your own self-confidence because, again, your self-trust is diminishing because you're not keeping the promises you make to yourself. So I don't think it's rocket science. It's figure out what you need to do. Again, there's a lot of resources out there. And then just do the things that you know you should be doing. Of course, it's easier said than done, but that's really the strategy to it. It's simple. It's not easy, but it's simple.
Yeah, I'm a huge advocate of being a person of your word. And I take your philosophy and I put a little bit of a twist on it for my own personal use. I'm somebody who's a big believer in speaking it into an existence. And if you're a firm believer in being a man of truth or a woman of truth and believing what you say, I always tell people the idea of something that I want to put forward, because now I'm speaking this out into existence. And if I'm a man of my word, then eventually I'm going to do it. And now I'm holding myself accountable as other people are holding me accountable as well. Maybe they won't personally, but I know that I've told them whatever I plan on doing, putting my foot forward, and so I should be able to do it. That was the same, like, when I did my antique store, I told multiple people. When I was doing the ticket verification app, I told multiple people. Before I started this podcast, I probably told 20 or 30 people the idea behind it. And eventually, you speak it into existence, and then when you're telling people the idea, when you start launching something, people have a lot more confidence in you, and there's a little bit more self-confidence and a little bit more truth and a little bit more support behind it. So it's just about saying what you're doing and then putting the action to the words.
Absolutely, man. I'm a huge believer in law of attraction and all that stuff, saying what you're going to do. It's funny because I think I posted this on Facebook a couple of years ago, but again, back to network marketing when, again, low self-esteem, low confidence, scared of the world, right? Looking for everyone else's approval, no bank account. I remember I wrote on a little card a couple of my goals. It was like make a six-figure income, buy my parents a house, get a Tesla, right? All these things that I really wanted. At the time, I didn't know if I really believed that I could achieve it, but I was just like, oh, the book told me to write my shit down, so I'm gonna go write it down. And it's crazy, you know, to look back 6 years, 5 years, and every single thing that I wrote down, I got. And I think there's this power in one, actually verbally saying it, and two, writing it down and just making sure that you're consistently holding it on the forefront of your mind. Because at the end of the day, you know, we will get out of this life what we believe that we're worth, not what we want, not what we deserve, but what we believe that we deserve. And by doing things like that, by you saying to me even, right, or the other 20 people you told you can do the podcast, now you know deep down that, like, I said this, your philosophy and your values is I'm a man of my word. So by you not doing this, now you're going against your inner values, which you're not going to do, right? So it makes it that much easier to take action on what you're trying to do. So I think there's definitely power of vocalizing what you're going to say, but at the same time, not just talking and not doing anything. Because I know me and you both know people, Jake, that just talk, lip service, but their feet never move. So I think there's a balance of saying what you're going to do, declare it once, then shut the hell up and just get to work and let the results speak for themselves.
Yep. And your results have definitely showed, like, through in and throughout multiple times. To continue on back with the story, so you're in Vegas, 2018, you're making all kinds of money, but obviously you hit some sort of stagnation, maybe it was mentally or maybe fiscally, and then you decided to venture on and create your own solar company. What were the mechanics behind that decision?
Yep, that's a great question. So it was about 8 months ago now. I had a great experience. So one thing that I learned from network marketing, another great lesson is I think we can all learn, is like I mentioned, I hopped around a couple different network marketing companies during that 3 years. I committed to three main ones, but I probably like dabbled in like five or six. And one thing going into the new industry of solar and door-to-door, I made a commitment that I wasn't going to do that again. I was going to find a company that I believe in, plant my flag down, and burn the boats, right? Because the issue, and I think we see this a lot, is everyone's looking for that new best opportunity, right? No one has the grit. When things are new, it's fresh, it's fun, it's exciting. But after a year, 2 years, 3 years, that excitement and that like that energy goes away. And then it's just like consistency and sustainability and just doing what you need to day in and day out, which is a lot not as sexy as starting something new every couple of years. But one of the lessons that I learned was every time you go to a new opportunity, at least in my space, is you lose credibility because I can't preach and tell people this is the best opportunity ever and this is going to help change your life. And then 6 months later, I'm in a new opportunity, right? That doesn't make sense. You lose credibility. So coming into solar, I was like, I'm going to find a company I vibe with and believe with and plant the flag. And thankfully, the first company I've ever been introduced with randomly, Zach Reisler, actually, shout out to Zach. He was the one that was working the company as well. It was an amazing company. I have nothing bad to say about them. And I was in there for 4 years. I just felt like towards the end, I almost kind of my growth was being stagnant in a sense, not stagnant because I'm 100% commissioned. Everything I do is based on my own performance and essentially I have unlimited potential, but based on the ecosystem that I was in, I just felt like there was more opportunity out there. And there was a, I just wanted to stretch myself. I almost felt too comfortable. And I think in life, when you start feeling too comfortable, that's the cue to go shake things up a little bit. Cause I was living pretty good. Like I had passive income to the fact where like I had a big enough team where I didn't have to sell personally anymore. And I was making a really good passive income. I was basically the top position in the company other than like the CEO and VP and stuff. And I was in a pretty comfy position. I'd go travel to California once a month. I go to another office once a month. I'd show up, do some speaking. And that was about it. If I really wanted to, but I just felt like I needed some more. So it's funny how everything worked out. I actually was planning on looking at another opportunity by myself. And I started dabbling on seeing what it would look like to create my own solar dealership. And, you know, I'm a firm believer of always making your rivals your idols, right? Like, obviously, you want to respect the people that got that help you and support you. But at the end of the day, right, like Drake's a big mentor of mine, right? I'm shooting for Drake, right? I want to be his rival, because as a byproduct, I'm going to be a big deal, right? And maybe that's not realistic, or maybe it is, but like it's a good goal to desire for, right? Because you're striving towards something bigger than yourself. And if you hit it, great. If you don't, hey, cool. I'm close to Drake. That works for me. So for me, I was ready for the next step in my career. One of my mentors told me, Steven, you know, in opportunities like this, and I think this is relative to any opportunity, you want to plant your head down for 2 years and commit. Tunnel vision. Don't look to your left. Don't look at your right, and go all in. 2 years later, pick your head up, make sure like you're still liking what you're doing, make sure the opportunity is still good, make sure your boat's not sinking. If everything's good, plant your head down another 2 years. So you're not this popping your head up every 3 months and never getting enough consistency. That's what a lot of people do. They don't plant the flag in something long enough to really see any success because they're all about that instant gratification. So as I started looking for opportunities, I was this close to just going off by myself and starting my own dealership. And then because of some promises and some things that were made for my company, I ended up staying in my company because they offered me some stuff that made sense at the time to stay. And then 3 months later, I found out one of my mentors in the business, probably the biggest mentor I've had in the business, was looking around for the same thing. And he was kind of feeling the same concerns I was with the ability to grow and the future direction of the company moving forward. So myself and about five other partners decided that it made sense for all of us to partner up and put all of our resources together instead of individual companies, maybe individual companies of 100 people or 80 people, collab to one big company of 300-400 people, and use all of our strengths and launch it together. So that's kind of how this new thing was incepted. So, 5 years in solar, I've only been in two companies, one co-owner and the other one, was my original company that you know, super grateful for. It got me to where I needed to be.
Yeah, it's like what we were saying earlier. There's a golden path and you see the light at the end of the tunnel, and eventually you have to step out of your comfort bubble to get where you want to be. But eventually that comfort bubble comes back to cover you up. And so sometimes it's hard to realize it. But once you do, you realize it's the next step forward. And that's something that you realized. And it seems like you're pretty good at pattern recognition over time, you know, going back to New Jersey, where you decided after 3 days, this wasn't for you. And so you knew that your time was coming to an end. And now you're a co-founder of Sunder Energy. And can you give us a little bit of an explanation of what Sunder Energy is?
Yeah, absolutely. So how the solar industry works, guys. So there's a couple different components. So Sunder Energy is essentially a sales dealership. So think of like a car dealership. You go to a car dealership and they sell multiple different cars. You can get a Ford, you can get a Toyota, right? So we're essentially a solar sales dealership. We don't install panels. We don't make panels. We don't finance panels. We're essentially a sales engine. So we partner with install companies that actually do the construction side of it. And we partner with finance companies that actually finance the system. And our job is essentially to sell the equipment, sell it. So a couple different ways. Our flagship product is essentially a PPA. That's a way to go solar, where how it works is, rather than having to buy or lease panels anymore, we basically will provide the equipment to absolutely no cost to the customer. And then rather than them pay NV Energy for like coal and dirty and all that bad stuff for the environment at a higher rate every single month, well, essentially all you do is you just buy the energy from the solar system at a discounted rate for clean energy every single month. So essentially it's just a bill swap. You pay $200 a month. We'll put a system on there. It doesn't cost you anything out of pocket. And then you pay $150 a month. You get a cheaper locked in rate. It's better for the environment. Obviously solar is the future, and it increases the home value of the home. And so our job specifically is just to find people that are looking for more out of life, right? That are sick and tired of being sick and tired and are open to learning a new skill set. Door to door is not easy, but it's extremely rewarding. A lot of people say 2 years of door to door is equivalent to a bachelor degree in communication, just because of the skill set, the fortitude, the mindset, the resilience that you learn. And, you know, it's been an awesome experience. We have sales reps across the country. We're open in, you know, Nevada, Utah, Colorado, Texas, Illinois, Florida. I'm missing a couple more off the top of my head. And yeah, most of the guys are just, you know, young and hungry, looking for opportunity. They don't want to, you know, go work a normal 9-to-5 and be told what to do and when to do it and be, you know, controlled on their pay. And they'd rather work for themselves as an independent contractor, work when they want, create the results they want. Because at the end of the day, you can only make as much money as you're allowed to. So if you're working for someone else, there's a cap. If you work for yourself, there's no cap. And, you know, we try and facilitate an environment where personal development, growth, and ultimately financial literacy is at the core of it.
Yeah. So essentially sky's the limit, since you're only capped by your ability. But I want to make sure, just so everyone knows. So in the solar industry, there's three different types of company, correct? There would be the door-to-door sales, which would you do, the equipment provider, who also does the installation, and the financing arm?
Correct. Yeah. So three components. There's the dealership, right? So that could be in the form of door-to-door, online marketing, billboards, ads, right? Traditional sales, right? So they're the ones that actually bring the product to the consumer, right? Whether it's door to door or whatever. There's the installer. So the installer, we're partnered with a company called Freedom Solar, Freedom Forever. They're the green trucks. They're the ones that actually do the construction. They go on the roof, they check the roof, they're nailing the hammers and cranking the wrenches and doing the whole construction side of it. And then there's the finance company, which we use a company called Sunrun, which is a really big company. They're the ones that are actually financing the solar system. They're the ones paying for it. When the customer signs their agreement, it's a Sunrun piece of paper, because they're the ones that are essentially financing the system. So again, I really like this model. There's other companies that do all three, right? That are all vertically integrated. They do the sales, the install, and the finance. I really like just controlling what we're good at the end of the day. You know, I think it's all about doubling down on your strengths and kind of saying F you to your weaknesses. So I don't want to deal with financing. I don't want to deal with managing an install team. I like what I do, which is build, grow, recruit, train, and lead people. And if we can just get the best at that and find other people who are the best at what they do, it's meant for a pretty dynamic relationship.
Yeah, it's literally a combination of your whole entire journey package into one business. And earlier you were saying that essentially what it is a bill swap. Is there a possibility of your bill being lower than it is currently?
So always, yeah. So every time that you go solar, not, I shouldn't say always, but the majority of the time it's based on the customer. The bill that you get from us will be anywhere from 15 to 20% cheaper than what you're currently paying with NV Energy currently. But the cool side of that is, it's actually a fixed in rate for 25 years. So you'll see initial savings right off the bat, but the main reason people go solar from the economic standpoint is to have that protection over term. You know, it's almost, I say this in sales presentations, it's like, Mr. Customer, if you could lock in your gas rates 20 years ago, would you? Of course, right? Because then you'd be paying $1 a gallon instead of $3 a gallon. That's basically the opportunity with solar. It's just to get a consistent, predictable rate, just like homeowners have fixed mortgages most of the time, not variable mortgages. So they know every single month what they're paying. That's essentially the opportunity with solar. It's a service. So just like Cox or DirecTV, they come out, they install their satellite dish, and then the only thing you buy every month is the cable subscription. Same thing. We install the solar system. The only thing you buy is a service, which is the electricity. It's just cheaper than what you're currently paying because we don't have to pay all these delivery fees to get the power from the power plant to your house because it's essentially generated on site on top of your roof.
Yeah, and I think the traditional General Electric company is starting to feel that effect, because I have noticed now that when you pay power, you can almost lock in a fixed rate as well. But what people don't take in is that the traditional AC power, they have surge pricing now, especially in Vegas when it's hot. You know, I've seen bills go from 200 in the winter to 500-600 in the summer just because of how hot it gets.
And exactly. And
go ahead.
And the cool thing about the solar industry that I really like, it's a solution to a big problem, right? The way I view solar and why I think it's such a lucrative industry, it's because we're in the 21st century, kind of like we touched on, right? We have Netflix and Airbnb and Uber and Lyft and Facebook and all these things. We're not using the same cell phone that our parents used 10 years ago. We're not watching TV the same way that our parents did 10 years ago, right? So why are we getting the power the same way that our parents did 10 years ago? Just like Blockbuster, right? Blockbuster was the monster in video and movies, right? They had a bunch of hard stores all around the country, maybe even all around the world. You'd go in to get the experience, you go get the tape, you bring it back. It just wasn't very efficient. Netflix comes in, they're like, why would you drive all the way to a store, pick it up, deal with people, and then drive back when you can just stream it from your house? It's just more efficient. It's just innovation and technology disrupting another industry. It's the same thing with solar. It's like, why would you buy your power from 500 miles away, pay more for something that's polluting the planet, when you could slap a piece of equipment on your house that does the exact same thing, doesn't pollute the planet, and it's cheaper? So the way that I look at it is just technology and innovation disrupting another industry. The carbon industry is one of the biggest industries in the world. They're second to healthcare, believe it or not, goes healthcare. And then electricity. It's a $1.3 trillion industry with a T. So the way I see solar is, if it's anything like the Netflix to the Blockbuster, the Uber to the taxi cab, or Airbnb to hotels, or Netflix to cable, it's projected to have a pretty big piece of market share. And I think it's just a matter of time until people start waking up and realizing that, hey, it's just evolution at this point.
Yeah. And I agree. We are moving forward. I think we're going to see a lot of innovation due to this quarantine and people realizing that a lot of things weren't specifically needed, like in-person meetings, remote home from work, and so on and so forth. But I do have a bigger question. So we are talking about pushing technology forward, and solar is such an innovative technology. People are pushing green solar power, wind power, everything and so forth. Why resort to traditional salesman door-to-door tactics for such an innovative product?
Absolutely. That's a good question, Jake. So we believe that solar is a product that goes on the home, so it should be sold in the home. Believe it or not, door-to-door is actually a pretty lucrative industry. When I first heard about door-to-door, when I was about to go out to pest control, I was like, what? Like door-to-door? Like, I'm not Mormon. No offense if you're Mormon. Like, I'm not Mormon. That's weird, like old school, especially coming from network marketing where everything's remote, online, right? We're taking pictures of money in our hand, all this like flashy stuff. I'm like, I'm about to go knock on people's doors. Like that sounds weird, but it's actually a super lucrative industry. So think about this for a second. Companies spend millions and millions of dollars on marketing, advertisement, and hourly salespeople. For example, you go into a car lot, right? Car salesman, for example. You go into a car lot. That car salesman is getting paid hourly. They're marketing, so you click on their ads, right? There's a bunch of different people doing financing and all this crazy stuff. There's a lot that goes in to get someone to show up to a car lot, a lot of marketing dollars. That's why when a car salesman makes a deal, it's only like $200, $300 commission or something like that. With solar or door-to-door, not just solar, any door-to-door industry, all that is taken away. There's no marketing, there's no ads, there's no any of that, right? There's no hourly pay. It's simply they're able to take all that money that would be normally given to the average mediocre people, regardless if they perform or not, and they're taking all that money and giving it to the person who is willing to go out there and perform and get sales. That's why there's so many door-to-door people. It's crazy when people, you know, still even to this day, when I used to, when I knock on doors, people are like, oh, you know, I feel bad for you out here. It's like, you wouldn't feel bad if I knew I was making more money than you would. Like, not to be mean or anything like that, but it's like the potential for earning is crazy. But most people don't think about it because it's like this random door-to-door dudes on our door, right? It's almost like kind of a lesser of a career and profession. But yeah, I think there'll always be a need for human interaction, to answer your question, Jake. I think as we get more desensitized, can you say the word, to with technology and Facebook ads and Instagram and Zoom, the value for human communication and emotion will be higher than it will ever. And I think solar is a little bit more complex of a sale. So you can't really get the full experience by just clicking and Googling it. Of course you can, but I think there will always be a need for that human connection, for someone to sit in the home, answer your questions, explain, show that there's a real face-to-face human here, and make sure that they feel comfortable with the person they're doing business with.
Yeah, it's I guess that makes sense. It's sort of a sentimental feel. Whenever people do renovations to their house, they're usually going out to the hardware store. They're going and meeting people face-to-face because their home is their palace, and their emotion and their well-being is tied to it. So if they're going to make
construction,
it,
right?
Yeah, it's construction, and it's a large decision. Even if you may not be paying for it, it's something that's going to improve your home, and you're also saving the environment and getting and moving on to more innovative technologies. So 100%, that actually makes sense. And so you actually have me pretty convinced on solar. Let's say you do a door-to-door sale and the person agrees. Kind of what is the contract like? And then once the pen's to paper, how long until it's installed?
Yep, great question. So the actual sales process only takes about an hour of the sit-home consultation. It's pretty quick. So traditional PPA, which is what I just explained, is 25-year contract. So they're essentially agreeing to purchase power from us at a set rate for 25 years. So we're able to protect their rates against any inflation from NV Energy for 25 years. We have other loan options that we could do as low as 5 years, as high as 25 years, just depending on what the customer's goals are and what they're trying to get out of the product. The actual install, so from signing pen to paper to install, right now our average install is about 21 days, which is pretty crazy to say because when I started the industry 5 years ago in Nevada, the average install took 5 months. So wow. to see the progress in the industry and just how much it's evolving, because solar is still a newish industry. It's actually less than 3% market penetration across the country compared to other home services like alarms or roofing or something like that, which is in the high 60s. So the fact that the progress has been made that much, I mean, our fastest install out here in Nevada that I've seen so far is 4 days. So you sign, you check the roof, and then 2 days later it's on the roof, which is pretty crazy. But yeah, I think that's what makes the solar industry even more attractive nowadays, is because the pushback that I used to get in the past is like, yeah, you know, I like solar and I like the concept, but compared to this other sales opportunity, it just takes so long to get paid. But now, because we're able to get really big commissions as well as get the glass on the roof as quick as possible, we've been seeing a lot less cancellations, a lot higher retention rate, and ultimately, the most important part, a lot happy customers.
Yeah, that's incredible, dude. That's a 80% increase, maybe a little more in the time of speed. That's incredible. Is that doing to just the solar industry as a whole, or partly your team has fixed a lot of these inadequacies within the system?
I think it's a combination of both for sure. I think the reason that we picked our install partner, which was part of the reason we transitioned from our previous company, to be honest, it wasn't even the actual sales company that we weren't too happy with. It was their relationship and the autonomy with their install partner. Because in solar, really in any relationship in business, you need two people functioning well. You need them to communicate well, and you need good autonomy. Because if not, then there's going to be dysfunction in the relationship, and it's going to create a bad experience for both parties. And that's that's what was happening in our previous company a little bit. So the reason we picked this installer is one, because we felt like they're the fastest and the most efficient. And we knew that if we did our job right and correctly, they would do their job right. And if we can just both focus on what we're good at getting sales, training, culture, leadership, they're good at slapping glass, then it would be a pretty solid relationship. And so that's a big part of it. And then just the industry as a whole, just growing and just getting better. And, you know, the utility getting better at working with us and permitting getting quicker, because solar is a little bit more complex than a normal sales job, just because it does have to do with the government and electricity. And there's some legislation stuff that gets involved. So just getting all that dialed in, it's been super cool to see the progress of the industry as a whole.
That is incredible. And in a time where technology and innovation is pushing the speed for everything, that's something that everyone focuses on now. You know, we swipe and we scroll through social media, even if there's no refresh, you just continue doing it because you just want information and speed and rate and shortening games and whatever the case is. So it's cool to see you guys are literally stepping in line with where innovation is going towards. It's incredible to see. And does everyone qualify for solar, or is there anything that can hold people back from getting solar panel on the roof?
Three main qualifiers. You need to spend at least $65 a month on your energy bill, which is most people here in the Valley. Second one is the roof. So the roof has to be in decent condition. You know, obviously can't install pieces of equipment on a roof that's going to fall apart, you know, after we install it. So we do a roof inspection to make sure that the roof is structurally sound. And then the final thing, there is a credit requirement. So typically it's about a 650 FICO score. So as long as they pass those three things, again, zero out of pocket, we put the panels up there and then just pay a cheaper power bill every month.
Solar's taking over. I love it. And also if I'm a young, inspiring kid, or maybe not even young, but you know, I'm good as a salesman and I want to look into solar, how does this process go?
Yeah, absolutely. So you can obviously contact me, or if you know anyone in Sunder out here in Vegas, or you know, if anyone else is viewing around the country, like I said, we have about 30 offices and I think it's like 12 different states or something like that. Just go ahead and contact myself. We do a quick interview process with the quarantine and everything. We probably do it over Zoom, mainly just looking for just characteristics. Again, door-to-door sales in general is not for everyone. Again, most people, unfortunately, they're so conditioned to have an employee mindset where if they're not being told what to do, when to do it, go work today, take a break now. A lot of people don't have that self-starting mentality to go out there and do it. So we just want to make sure that we're not going to set you up for failure, because at the end of the day, you eat what you hunt out of something like this, which could be scary for a lot of people, 100% commission. But for the people that understand the value in that and understand the potential for growth and monetary gain, it's pretty unbelievable what some people are making. I mean, we have, you know, 18, 19 year olds that are just coming straight from high school that are making more there than parents within the first 6 months, not having to clock in, you know, doing an awesome job and more importantly, developing a skill set that'll serve them past the solar industry and past, you know, what we're doing here. So I would just recommend anyone who is kind of in a situation where maybe they want more out of life, or they're just trying to be around some positive people that, you know, strive for greatness and that have dreams that they're not scared to go after, definitely hit the phone.
It's amazing to see. I think throughout, we've been talking now for about an hour and a half, if people haven't noticed, your leadership style is, it's very unique and it's very forward thinking. And as more as I've seen through social media that, you know, you, a few days ago, you were just giving a free seminar and investment advice. I've seen rock, paper, scissors of $500 tournaments, just very untraditional like bosses where you're not even micromanaging, and all these other different aspects, which I'm sure you could touch on. How important is it to change the traditional leadership style in this sort of industry?
I believe leadership is everything. Everything rises and falls on leadership at the end of the day, whether we're talking about the government or we're talking about companies, we're talking about schools, families, parenting, everything, right? I think leadership is one of the most underrated skill sets in the world that people don't realize it's a skill set, just like dribbling a basketball, right? It's a skill set. You have to practice every single day and you get better at it. So I think it's the most important. My philosophy in business, and again, I learned this from network marketing, is when you build the people will build the business. Most people focus on a sales team, for example, on moving product. Oh, we need to sell more solar. We need to sell more cars. We need to sell this or that, revenue, yada, yada, yada. when in reality, it's not people that move product, it's people that are moved that move product, right? It's people that are inspired and that are excited and happy to be there. I've, over the last 6 or 7 years, I've done a lot of studying on the human brain and just personal development and neuro-linguistic programming and a bunch of different skill sets. Again, all free, self-education, YouTube, that I've took it upon myself to learn. I believe in Jim Rohn's quote that, you know, formal education will make you a living, but self-education will make you a fortune. And that's what we try to preach to our team. I'm a firm believer that if I can add value to people without expecting anything in return, and value isn't always money. Value could be mentorship. It could be support. It could be empathy. It could be guidance. It could be giving someone a book, right? There's a lot of different ways to add value. But when you add value and you can change someone's life like that, they're going to do whatever they can to support you and your vision and what you're trying to accomplish. Martin Luther King, 50, 60, 70, 80 years ago, I'm not a good history buff, but he was able to get 50, 60,000 people into a courtyard without social media, without Facebook, without cell phones, because people believed in his cause so much that they were willing to show up there. Yet we can't even get people to sit in a classroom for, 20 minutes without freaking out because their attention span are checking Facebook. And it's just lack of leadership. So what we're trying to create in our organization or just in life in general is just like, how do we teach people? Like, how do we give people resources and mentorship? And, that's really what my passion is. I mean, solar and door to door is the vehicle, but what I'm so passionate about is just helping people change their life and not just monetary, but giving them the perspective, giving them the concepts, giving them the philosophies that I've learned over the last 7-8 years that has made such a big impact in my life. And I know if I can share that, even if they can even take one little piece of that information and apply it in their life, then that'll put them on the right trajectory to getting what they want as well.
Yeah, I think that's something that our generation, millennial generation, and you're starting to see even in the Zoomers, Generation Z, is that an emphasis on experience and an emphasis on your social well-being, because a lot of this generation wasn't grown up and fortunate enough to have this type of money, so they had to innovate. And now you see that all of our generation, they want to go out and experience festivals. They want to try to find their adequate role and purpose within a company. And you're able to notice that, and you're able to capture that within your different tactics.
Absolutely. And, unfortunately, and especially in corporate America, there's a lot of bosses out there, not many leaders, right? People that are willing to put profits before people. And that's why there's so much attrition in these businesses. And that's when there's so many people revolting. And, the whole millennial thing, if you guys don't follow Simon Sinek, I would highly recommend checking him out on YouTube. Start with Why, but he talks about this a lot on how it's not a millennial thing, especially our generation. Like, I think millennials in our generation are the most like passionate, creative, forward-thinking generation that's ever been. But it's people don't know how to lead those types of people because they're so used to their old traditional ways of leadership, where they're putting profits before people, and they're focusing more on shareholders, and they're focusing more on how to move the bottom line and their revenue streams and all this stuff, and not focusing on the people. When in reality, if they understood the concepts of actual leadership, they would know that they put more emphasis on growing the people, that all those things that I just talked about would get taken care of probably more than just focusing on the actual numbers themselves. So I think people are just looking for a place to feel valued, and they're looking for a community, and they're looking for to be a part of something bigger than themselves. And for the people that are able to create that, whether it's a sales team or a company or organization, I think those are the people that are going to be able to thrive. True human connection and good leadership to facilitate that.
It's something that our country and even the world needs. Do you know who Eric Weinstein is?
Sounds familiar.
He's a regular guest. Yeah, he's a regular guest on Joe Rogan. He was he's a theoretical physicist turned macroeconomist who worked for Peter Thiel Capital, and now he's going back to being a social character. He talks about just the lack of leadership all over, and the oligarchy in academia, and how a lot of the older generation, like you were saying, they use their traditional models to implement on the new generation, where we are not following that model at all, and that there needs to be a way for us to break out of this. And like how we have everyone who's running for president is over 70 years old, and not being an ageist, but it's just all their perspectives are off, and a lot of it doesn't coincide with our generation's type of feelings and their type of forward thinking. And we're not just a for profit. Yeah, everyone likes money, but it's just not it's not solely the number one thing on everyone's outlook is just money. We want to be able to survive in this planet, and through climate change is something that is number one on our radar, and solar is like one of the biggest preventers for climate change.
Absolutely, yeah. Money is the byproduct. That's what people don't understand. Everyone's focused on making money. I know for the first, you know, 3, 4, 5 years of my career, I was just all about making money. How do I make the most money? When in reality, money is the side effect. It's the byproduct, right? Focus on adding value and the money will come. Focus on supporting people and the money will come. Focus on, you know, providing a service for people and the money will come. Most people focus so much on money, but they don't realize unconsciously, they're actually focusing on the lack of money. So they're going to continue to attract more of the lack of money. So they're just minor perspective shifts that, again, I'm grateful that I've learned through my experiences of quote unquote failure, right? What we talked about, to give me that hindsight to be able to hopefully help other people, you know, do the same.
Dude, this out, where are we at? An hour and 40 minutes now. This has been full of nuggets, literally dozens and dozens of them. I love it. But there's a few solar powered questions I'm going to ask you. I couldn't think of a better name, so I'm probably gonna get some flack for saying that, but
it's perfect.
Just a few exit questions, just to see. As you were saying, you've been doing a bunch of research on the human mind over the last 7 years, and you've been influenced by a lot of books. What are some books that you recommend to the listeners?
Absolutely. First book I've ever read that changed my life is a book called Think and Grow Rich by Napoleon Hill. I think it's the OG of the OG. It was written back in the, you know, I think the late 1800s, but it's super relevant to where we are today. I think it's a really good foundational book for people that are starting to change their thinking, because I'm a firm believer that success is all internal. It's your mindset, 90% mindset, 10% mechanics. And once you get the right philosophy right, you start thinking the right way, that good opportunities and circumstances will just attract to you. So Think and Grow Rich is a really good one. Another one that I really like is The Four Agreements. It's not business specific, but it just teaches you how to become an all-around better person. And at the end of the day, you bring yourself with you wherever you go. So you might as well make sure you like the person that you are as a person. So I like, Four Agreements is a quick read. And then Think and Grow Rich, I would recommend. And then another good one is The Alchemist by Paulo Coelho. It's a fiction story, but it just talks about basically a story of this guy. And it just gives a lot of life lessons about going after your dreams and manifestation in a kind of a fairy tale story setting.
I've read two of those books. They are incredibly inspirational. The year is 2030. Where does the solar energy sector stand?
It's a good question. 2030. So 10 years from now, I think solar is going to be just, like I talked about, we're about 3% market penetration. It's hard to tell, but with compound interest, I would say we'd probably be around 20 to 25%. So California, for example, has been the leader in solar basically for the last 10 years. There's a mandate now that every single new home built in California needs to have solar on it. So 100% of homes in California, new builds, have solar on it. I would imagine a lot of the country follows what California does, at least on the West Coast. So I'd imagine we take a page out of that book as well. But I see it more of a common item, kind of similar to like the cell phone industry. There's a thing called Law of Disruption of Innovation. It's by Simon Sinek, and it's basically a growth curve that shows how trends are adopted in the United States. And it talks about the first like 3% that catch up on a trend or the early adopters. And then it gets into the masses, majority, and then the laggers. It's kind of the trend. I'd recommend checking it out. So for example, the cell phones, right? At first, when cell phones launched, it was only the rich people that could afford them, right? It was only 3% of the country that can afford them. And then about 12% started getting into it as more people started seeing it. And then the masses, and then finally the laggers. The laggers are people that the only reason they have cell phones is because you can't buy flip phones anymore. I think something similar is happening with solar, where we're right around that 3%, where a lot of people think solar is only for the rich. But I would imagine in the next 10 years, we'd probably get to where people understand the value of it and the concept of it. And the cool thing about solar is technology and innovation are getting cheaper every single year, right? Because of technology and innovation, technology costs go down every single year. But on the flip side of that, utility rates go up every single year because the current infrastructure just isn't sustainable. You know, drunk driver runs into a power line, bird flies into a power center, windstorm blows down a transmission line, right? That's all money the utility company has to spend, invest in their infrastructure to repair it, right? That money needs to come from somewhere. So as fossil fuels and stuff continue to get more expensive because there's a finite amount of it, solar systems will continue to decrease. So it's getting to the point where it literally doesn't make sense. If it's cheaper, better for the planet, and more efficient, where you shouldn't have these things on your house. So that's where I see, I don't know if that's 10 years from now, 15 years from now, but something that I believe in is you can't stop a solution to a problem. And I believe it's a big solution.
It's a huge solution. It's just like when demand increases, supply increases, therefore the price usually goes down. So that's all in time. What's one quote to live by?
One quote to live by. That's a good question. I love quotes. One quote to live by is one that I have on my Instagram, which is one of my favorites. It says, "The opposite of courage in society is not being cowardice, but it is conformity." And I know we talked about that a little bit, but I truly believe that that's true, that, you know, being a coward isn't the worst thing that you can be, but it's conforming to everyone else. In a nation, in a society where everyone is almost a carbon copy and they're basically just following what everyone else is doing, following the news, following what their parents told them they do because they think that's what they should be doing, versus them being their own individual and thinking for themselves. That's the issue with most people. They just don't think, right? They're exercising thought, but it's different from thinking. But when you can really take a step back and kind of zoom out and have a different perspective on what's going on in your life, you're able to kind of see these things and pick up on these cues of like, maybe I don't have to do that, or maybe I can do this. And you start asking yourself better questions. The thing is, when you ask yourself better questions, guess what? You get better answers. So I would say that quote has been a staple in my life, because all the times that I thought about quitting or going back to a normal job, or maybe this isn't for me, or, you know, maybe I should just go out instead of maybe studying or reading this book. That quote has stuck with me and it helped me get through it.
Yeah, the definition of a quote unquote normal job is changing over time. A lot of the offices are disappearing over time. People are moving, work from home. In Vegas, a normal job is working on the strip, serving alcohol, but, you know, it's a huge industry. So I think it depends on your perspective. And one last question. It's for the heart. What does Las Vegas mean to you?
I love Las Vegas, man. So I was actually born in New York, but I moved here when I was like 2 years old. So technically I'm born in Brooklyn, New York, but I'm definitely Vegas raised. And no, Vegas has my heart, man. Is, you know, I love it. It's one of the places for me that I feel home. I catch myself always, because I deal with a lot of people that don't live in Vegas, whether it's my teams or friends or whatever. And you know, it surprises them how passionate I am about when I talk about Vegas. And I lived in a couple different places: San Diego, super dope place; San Jose, right, pretty cool place, right next to Silicon Valley; San Francisco; Colorado is a pretty cool place. And out of all the things, minus the cost of living or anything else, Vegas definitely has my heart. There's just so much things here to do, and there's a special type of vibe here. And for people that are like, oh, strip's dirty and stuff like that, it's like they just don't understand it, right? People's perspective here is to come here and let their demons out, where a lot of people here make this their home. And, you know, they're trying to create futures and some awesome things for their life. So, yeah, Vegas is home. If I could live anywhere else in the world, to be completely honest, I don't think I would move. Maybe later in my life, I'd maybe, but as of right now, there's nowhere else I'd rather be.
Something that I try to tell everybody: Vegas is unique, but outside of the strip, there's so many emerging markets that are growing. And that's something that with this podcast I'm trying to do, is just showcase everything that's going on outside of the strip. And that the persona of Vegas, even though Nevada may be one of the last in education, it's very hustle and entrepreneurship driven. You know, people go make potentially six figures on the strip, and then they'll go start a side business. And this kind of process just gets repeated over and over and over. And maybe they don't succeed the first time, but they grow accustomed, and eventually they do something for themselves, whether it's an actual business or a brand or personality or media company, whatever the case is. It's just something. And you're one of the bright spots because of it.
Thank you, man.
Hey, so before we go, where can everyone who's listening, where can they follow you on social media, and how can they get involved in Sunder Energy?
Absolutely. So mainly on Instagram, still funny handle. It's at Steven C. Jew, S-T-E-V-E-N-C, Jew. Facebook, obviously, I'm on. Those are really the two platforms I'm on the most. And yeah, just hit me up. Definitely, if you have my number, if we know each other, definitely just shoot me a text. But yeah, you can definitely find me on Instagram. We post a lot of lifestyle and a lot of, we basically give a lot of sneak peek of the company through the Instagram filter. And you guys can kind of take a peek at the lifestyle and kind of what we're about and what we represent. So if you guys are interested in checking it out, give me a follow. And if you want to pull the trigger, just shoot me a DM and we can get it going.
I hope if anyone is interested from this podcast, please say that you heard it from the Guest List Pod. I just want to see if this kind of publicity has been getting out there. And I hope that we can move some of you guys into a quote unquote normal job with Sunder Energy. Steven, I want to thank you for this. This has been an incredible conversation. I've got chills from this. I knew this conversation would be to a peak, but this level is astronomical. So I want to thank you for that.
I appreciate having me on, bro. It's always good to connect with the twin.
Twin life, all day. Shout out Alon Banner if you're listening to this. Before we go, if you guys are listening, whatever platform, please like, subscribe, comment, review. Like I said, we're trying to get this to the top. If you want to follow this podcast on social media, it's at the Guest List Pod on all social media accounts. If you want to follow myself, it's at Jake Gallen, and on Twitter, it's at Jake Gallen _. Still trying through Twitter to get that at Jake Gallen. No one's been on that handle for 8 years now, and I'm fucking annoyed by it. But over time, I guess it could finally become an official tag. Steven, once again, thank you so much. This was an amazing conversation.
Thank you, brother. I appreciate you having me on.